do not decide what your next new car will be, at least not for the next 30 minutes, because tonight on Top Gear, we reveal the results of the most comprehensive customer satisfaction survey ever carried out on Britain's cars. Welcome to a special edition of the show to mark this year's Top Gear JD Power Customer Satisfaction Survey. Here in the studio, we have some very brave members of the motor industry who have come along to face their customers and face the music.
These cards represent every model in our survey, and I'll be flipping them down and counting them through from the could-do-betters at this end to the shining examples at the other. And then we'll be unveiling these, the top five most satisfying cars in Britain. You'll hear about the joys, the woes, the good, the bad, and the ugly straight from the horse's mouth.
I couldn't actually get in the car without taking the roof off or getting in through the boot. No, I wouldn't get another one, not a chance. I'm selling it now.
The whole package is quite a disgrace, really.
I have no regrets whatsoever.
But first, before we get stuck into this year's survey, here's Vicky and Tiff with a bit of background info.
This JD Power survey is the largest ever study into buying, owning and living with a car in the UK today. And because it's all about your experience out here in the real world, tonight's opinions are not ours, but yours.
Nearly 30,000 owners of S and T registered cars have been surveyed, providing information about 182 different motors. Virtually every type of owner and car is represented, providing the most comprehensive list yet.
As well as polling owners about the performance and quality of dealer service, we asked other things, such as, do you like your car's looks? Are the seats comfy? Metal on every car surveyed.
This list is the result of all that hard work and places all 182 cars in order of what you lot think of owning them. At the end of the show, we'll announce which particular S or T reg has come out top. But before we get to that, there's 181 others to deal with. Adrian.
So to the worst first. It was the Vauxhall Sentra last year, you may recall. So let's see what sat in the cheap seats this time round. The Sentra again, well consistent, if nothing else, I suppose. Mercedes V-Class, riddled with faults. Alfa Romeo, you like its looks, but not cost of ownership. Vauxhall Frontera, Fiat, Kia, Rover Mini, God rest its soul. Nissan, Ford, another Rover, Fiat, Alfa Romeo, TVR, they can't be happy with 170. The Citroen Saxo, keep an eye out for Citroen, there's plenty of those in the bottom half. And a Fiat Coupe, Italy are having a shocker. Land Rover's much vaunted Freelander. And the pretty little Lotus Elise is pretty low down.
So, we're only 17 off the bottom, and we've already seen every British sports car in the survey. The MGF, the TVR Chimera, and the Lotus Elise are all down there in the twilight zone. So what on earth is going on?
The British sports car. You can't deny it's got a certain ring to it. The Elise, MGF, and the TVR Chimera still flying the flag with pride. Lovely to look at, great fun round country lanes, and an absolute scream on a track.
But according to their owners, it didn't take long for the novelty to wear off. These cars were bought as a route for some fun and excitement, but it seems that owning one is just a shortcut to frustration.
The first problem was the
delivery time.
Delivery time, wasn't it? It took 20 weeks when we were told initially 11 weeks.
And when we went to collect it, one of the employees of the dealer actually opened a door onto the car.
Yeah, and tried to blame us for it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, suspension's gone twice.
That's right, yeah.
We've had loss of power in the BBC valve.
It had a dent on the first service, which wasn't repaired the first time.
Yeah.
It took them two attempts to get it right.
Actually sold the car 2 weeks ago after 18 months of, I would say, sheer agony. It was off the road for a total of 6 or 7 weeks. I had a door lock mechanism motor which failed. I couldn't actually get in the car without taking the roof off or getting in through the boot.
On its first service, had the oil replaced. Unfortunately, a couple of weeks later, I discovered that there was actually no oil in the engine. So the old oil had been removed, but new oil hadn't been put in. Also, you can hear the clutch. It's also very squeaky. That's from water leaking into the car and causing some rust there.
The main problems I had was with the dealer. Unfortunately, I had it broken into. They put the passenger window through. It took them 3 months to get the car back to me. I called them constantly and was fobbed off with rubbish excuses. When I eventually got the car back, it had glass in the passenger seat exactly as it did the day when it got broken into. They'd scratched the hardtop roof, scratched the sill, the brake discs were bright orange, the car was filthy, and it was just in an appalling state. No, I wouldn't get another one, not a chance. I'm selling it now. Do you want to buy it?
Ben Samuelson from TVR. How do you feel finishing so near the bottom of the survey?
Well, to be frank, we were extremely surprised as to where we finished, because we went out and did our own research and have found that the vast majority of our customers are extremely happy with their cars, that they come back again and again, because there's no way of getting that sort of, you know, performance and quality for the money anywhere else.
John Messant from Lotus. Lots of trouble, usually serious. That was what Lotus once stood for. How are you going to improve your position?
Well, I think there's a couple of issues here. Firstly, you're looking at cars from a couple of years back. And while obviously we're very concerned about those customers not being happy with those cars and wish to do everything we can to make sure they're happy with them, we have in fact extensively redesigned the car and we have got a new production facility for producing much higher quality cars. So we are as happy as we can be, although not complacent in the circumstances, that we're doing everything we can to make our customers happier.
John Parkinson from Rover MGF. The survey highlights big mechanical problems and serious dealer woes as far as MGF is concerned. But unlike these guys, you're a big volume player. Why can't you build the MGF right?
Okay, first of all, I think we recognise a number of the problems that were identified on the video. It is representative of cars built a couple of years ago. And in the last 10 months since the company's been under new ownership, we've put a lot more focus on MG. We've moved MGF onto a dedicated manufacturing facility and we've commissioned another final assembly build. So we're working
on it. Okay, so things have moved on. You are making some improvements. But what about those poor customers whose cars are older than that? I mean, Roy Salt, Wendy Hardman, you're in the audience with us. Are you happy with that response?
Not at all.
No. Roy?
Definitely not. I mean, if he wants people to come back for more business, then he better sort out the customers he's had in the past.
Wendy,
won't be buying another one.
Wendy, you're going to have another MGF?
Definitely not. I mean, I used to drive MG before I had the children. And once the children left home, I decided that once again, I would go with a vehicle that used to have a fabulous reputation. Never again. Never again.
So, let's crack on with the next chunk. Remember, all these cars you're about to see are still in the bottom third. So it begs the question, why aren't they doing better? At 166, it's goodbye to the British sports car. Volkswagen won't be happy with that. Range Rover, 31 years to get it right, still no luck. Another Alfa, another Fiat. Vauxhall problems inside and out for that. Another Rover, Jeep Wrangler, another Citroen. Toyota Previa, what's a Toyota doing down here? Daihatsu 4-Track, another Fiat. The lowest place, Renault, the Espace, another Citroen, Suzuki Jimny, another Fiat, Vauxhall Vectra, another Rover, Renault, Seat, Ford Kuga, and the Fiat Marea at 145 is the highest place Fiat of the survey. Ford Galaxy, Vauxhall, another Vauxhall, Peugeot, Chrysler, Renault, Ford, Suzuki, and the Land Rover Discovery at 136 is the highest placed Land Rover. Let's crack on. Proton, Suzuki, a couple of Americans here, the Nissan, Subaru, the Peugeot 206, another Alfa, Jeep Cherokee, Daihatsu, and the Citroen Zara at 125. Now, we've only covered the bottom third. We've got rid of every Land Rover, every Fiat, and all but one Citroen. In fact, they were the least satisfying of all the volume car manufacturers. Sounds like they could do with a bit of professional advice.
We'll be right back.
two reasons why Land Rover had problems in the survey. One was a victim of their own success. Land Rover sales were soaring through the 90s. They were ramping up production all the time, and I think they were getting some problems just getting used to that. The second problem was simply BMW. I think BMW neglected Land Rover. They never really got to grips with its problems. The factory is not the most modern in the world. It's not quite East European standard, but it's not far off. And I think there's a lot of work needed to be done there that really didn't get done. BMW just went and did its own 4x4 instead.
I think Fiat will be disappointed that they've come out poorly, but on the other hand, they'll be reassured, I think, that when they look at the figures, they'll find a lot of it is related to dealers. The dealers that they have perhaps are not the best, because in the past, the Fiat franchise wasn't the best itself, so you had the dealers who you had. Consequently, they really do have to address the quality of the dealers, because they are the interface between the factory and the consumer. There's no point spending $1 billion on a car if the dealers fall down on the job.
Citroën, I think, will be very, very disappointed, especially put alongside their sister company Peugeot, which is sort of mid-table along with the volume brands. Citroën seems to be a little bit still of the poor relation within the Peugeot-Citroën group.
PSA, Peugeot, does have a problem with the manufacturing processes, the quality of build within the Citroën factories. And also, I think, there's a residual problem with some of the dealerships as well. There is no reason, if some cars can be almost perfect, that the poorer cars shouldn't be nearer to them. The gap is still much too wide.
A lot of the problems that some of the poorly performing manufacturers have stem from their dealer network as much as from the cars themselves. A good dealer network can sell a mediocre car and provide a very satisfied customer.
We invited representatives from Land Rover, Fiat and Citroën to join us this evening to comment on the survey's findings. But Citroën said they couldn't provide anybody. Fiat said the same, and Land Rover declined to come, but did send this statement. It's a little bit long, so I'll just pick out the salient points. Land Rover is disappointed and believes that the quality of its vehicles has substantially improved since the acquisition of the company by the Ford Motor Company in July 2000. Well, we'll see, won't we?
So, let's tackle the remaining cars in the bottom half of the survey. Goodbye to Citroën, Vauxhall Omega, build and running cost. There's the Kia, Ford Mondeo there, Volkswagen Beetle. Now, this is interesting. Peugeot 806 followed by Alhambra. Plenty of MPVs in the bottom half of the survey. Ford 306 showing its age, as does the Cabriolet. Volkswagen Polo, another Rover. Nissan down there, Kia Pride. Daihatsu Shroud, you like the mechanicals, but not the performance. Peugeot 406, the Daewoo Lanos. Now, this is interesting again. Ford Scorpio followed by Focus. Ford have got seven cars in the bottom half of the survey. Suzuki Alto, Hyundai Coupe, Volkswagen Golf, Daewoo, Hyundai Accent, Renault Clio, Ford car, the M-Class, another Rover, and the Vauxhall Corsa. Now, this is interesting. This is Vauxhall's highest placed car. It puts them in the bottom 10 manufacturers. But overall, they have improved their position more than that of most other brands.
So that's good news, isn't it? Andrew Anders from Vauxhall. You must be pleased to have improved, but you're still in the bottom 10. What's your reaction to the survey?
Even though we stopped selling the Sintra 2 years ago, it's still disappointing it's down there. But the other products have improved. We've still got a long way to go. And the fact that the Vectra's moved off from bottom 2 years ago is well up there. The Omega and the Corsa, it is pleasing. It is a mixed bag, but on the upside, it's more good than bad.
The survey shows that right across the range of your products, there are build quality, there are mechanical, and there are especially dealer problems. Now, there are 535 Vauxhall dealers in the UK. What can you do to improve this situation?
We can continue investing in training and improving the stands of the dealers. I mean, this is an issue that faces the whole industry. It's not just Vauxhall. And we continue to invest money. There will always be dealers who won't satisfy everyone, but we do our best, and we will continue to learn, I suspect, from these surveys.
Of course, JD Power isn't just about gripes and groans. You've been telling us about things you like as well. So here's Tiff to cheer us up a bit.
Not all cars are just metal boxes on wheels. Some manufacturers actually manage to develop features which give their owners pleasure. So you end up with much more than just a car. According to the survey, it's the looks of the Audi TT that are the most appealing. And if they could, their owners wouldn't just park it on the driveway, they'd hang it on the wall. but they'd still have to service it, and that can often be painful. Unless you're a Jaguar owner, that is. They give their dealers top marks for service. But it's also worth giving Skoda a pat on the back. They came sixth overall in the dealer service table, beating the likes of Toyota and Mercedes-Benz. Car seats have a tough job. They have to put up with bottoms of all shapes and sizes. And it seems a big, comfy, leather-clad armchair suits her most, with the Lexus LS400 apparently being the best seat in the house. However, if your budget can't quite stretch to a luxury limousine, the seats in the Honda Accord and Seat Toledo both receive their owner's praise. And when it comes to being entertained in your car, the Lexus LS400 wins again. It's got the most appealing sound system by far. So, what would you like to listen to on it? Well, the best sounding car, of course, the TVR Chimera. Its owners love its exhaust note, and I think they've got a point.
OK, let's polish off the next 40. We're heading into the top half of the survey, so if your car appears next, you should be relatively satisfied. Goodbye Vauxhall, goodbye Proton at 96, the Alfa Romeo 166, the highest-placed Italian car. Didn't like the build on that one. Passat, the Rosa, the 121, Hyundai, Daihatsu again, you like the mechanicals, but not the performance. The Renault Laguna, Proton Persona, Mitsubishi, Ford Fiesta, the best-selling car in the survey year. Fit and finish wasn't up to scratch, but the sound system was. Mitsubishi Charisma, Honda Shuttle, again you like the build but not the running costs. The Nissan Primera, Seat Cordoba 81, Toyota Celica, you like the build and the performance but not the running costs again. The Nissan Patrol at 79, Hyundai Elantra, Suzuki Gran Vitara, Perodua and Nipa, you like the build and not the performance again. Honda Prelude, Isuzu Trooper, Volvo V40, the first Volvo there, 72, the 323, Mitsubishi Space Star, Nissan Almera, Honda HR-V at 69, the SLK at 68, what's it doing there, Mercedes? Daihatsu Grand Move, you like the build again on that, the MX-5, Daihatsu Sirion, the Saab, first Saab, Renault Safran, and Mercedes A-Class at 62, and right behind at 61, the CLK. We say goodbye to Citroën at 60, S40 Mitsubishi, and the first BMW, the Z3, Audi A3, Daewoo Laganza, and the Mercedes SL at 54. Now, that's six out of the nine Mercedes we've dismissed, and we're not even in the top 50. True enough, most of them are in the top half. But this is Mercedes we're talking about. They're supposed to be the finest cars in the world, aren't they?
This is a very famous badge. In its 100-year history, it stood for pedigree and quality. Unfortunately, according to our survey, this is a badge that's been trading on its past. The reputation is a far cry from the reality.
This is the replacement vehicle, because the first vehicle we had probably had as many miles going backwards and forwards to the garage as we actually did in it. We had gearbox failures, engine problems, electrical problems, sunroof exploded, it broke down with my wife at Sainsbury's at 10:30 one night. We had a complete brake failure. It went in for a service where they forgot to do the service. The whole package is quite a disgrace, really.
The first time we broke down, I phoned up Mercedes Recovery. They came out, put it on diagnostic because the engine of the car was just dead. And they said they'd never seen anything like it.
Three times in about 4 weeks, I think it was, from beginning to end.
We haven't covered 30 miles in total, I wouldn't have said, to be honest with you.
Mercedes's reputation has grown from making executive saloons, but it seems that deviating from that formula has bruised the badge. Maybe Merck should stick to what they do best.
So, Jeff Day from Mercedes-Benz, should you stick to what you do best?
Well, I think what we do best is build the finest cars in the world. There are two things we're very passionate about. One is the cars that we build, and we should be, because we invented it after all. And number two are the customers and the experience they have of owning and driving the world's number one luxury marque. And we'll work very hard to make sure that they get the service and the satisfaction they deserve.
Hang on just one moment. The V-Class most definitely isn't the finest car in the world. In fact, it's one from the bottom of the survey.
Apparently the seats in the sound system are the only truly satisfying things about it. This must cause you pain, physical pain, to see Mercedes-Benz so low.
Absolutely right.
What are you going to do about it?
Mercedes-Benz is a very broad church now. We build something for whoever you are, and we just have to make sure that wherever you're buying into Mercedes-Benz, you do get that number one ownership experience.
Elaine Cross, you had a M-Class, didn't you?
Right.
Certainly not the number one ownership experience that Mercedes promised, was it?
No, very, very disappointed. I mean, I think it's a lot of people's dream to have a Mercedes, and you expect quality, reliability. In fact, I've got a list here of, 20 problems I've had with the car. Some major, some minor, a lot of cosmetic problems. Rust on the bonnet, not a stone chip, rust.
You're not building the V-Class and the M-Class to the same quality level as the other cars, and the survey's reflecting that, isn't it?
Well, if it's not, we will make every effort to make sure that we do, because that is our commitment. And if it's to do with the product, then that's something that we have to look at, and we will try and make sure it's right for you.
Leather seats had to be restuffed. I've never had a car with leather seats before, but when you get...
This doesn't sound like a Mercedes to me.
A new fuel tank.
It's damaging the reputation of your company. That's
absolutely
what the survey's proving. What are you going to do?
We take very seriously every single case. And so if Elaine is happy, I'm more than willing to talk to her about that and to make sure that she actually starts to enjoy the Mercedes-Benz the way she should be.
OK, so let's complete the rundown. And the good news is, if you haven't seen your car yet, well, you're on to a winner. Mercedes, Toyota RAV4, you like the build quality, not the running cost. Honda, you like the dealerships as well. Hyundai did very well there at 50. Audi A4, you like the build quality. A8, you don't like the running costs. Mitsubishi Galant, Toyota MR2, Seat Toledo, the Volvo V70 at 44, you particularly like the interior. Impreza down to number 43, and now we reach a rich stream of Japanese cars with the Coupe, the Integra R, the Micra, the Demio, the Zados 6, the Honda Accord, and striking a blow for Britain, the Jaguar XK. You like the performance and the looks and love the dealers. And what's behind it? The highest placed Volkswagen, the Bora, and just ahead of that is the lowest placed Skoda. Not bad for the one-time poor relation of the VW group. And that puts them on a par with these guys. Porsche, not bad indeed. And BMW Series 3 doing well there, the Volvo S70, Daewoo, Nissan, Porsche again, Audi A6 again, build quality and performance you love. Toyota, Subaru doing well, Suzuki, Toyota Land Cruiser again, build quality and dealers are all doing well there. Mercedes S-Class, that's a bit more like it, Toyota again, the Jaguar S-Type, Volvo S80, Toyota again, Subaru, Mazda 626, and now number 12, the Skoda Octavia, their best placed car. That is again more like it, Mercedes with C-Class, and now we're well and truly entrenched in luxury land. The poshest car you can buy with a Toyota badge, the Camry. No surprises from the BMW 5 Series, best placed Mercedes, the E-Class at 8. At 7, it's the Jaguar XJ Series. Again, you love the dealer's performance and looks. And the first Lexus of the night with the IS 200 at number 6.
And so to the top 5. Well, it fair warms the cockles of your heart, doesn't it? At number 5, it's the Rover 75. So, dare we start talking about a brave new era of the British motor industry?
They were the class of 98. The Jaguar S-Type and Rover 75 grabbed all the headlines at the Birmingham Motor Show. This was the Brit pack we'd been waiting for. But both were criticised for looking too retro by far. Were they up for the job? Well, it seems they were.
The S-Type turned out to be really quite consumer, like all the interior features, and they simply adore the engines.
When I was looking for a motor car, I looked at BMWs, I looked at Mercedes, and at the end of the day, I decided that Jaguar was my car. It was a British car, I was English, and that was my decision, and I have no regrets whatsoever.
The Rover 75 did quite superbly in the survey. According to its owners, it's just about perfect. It finishes in the top 10 when it comes to seats, handling and braking, its stereo and cabin design. They even like the way it looks.
It's the most comfortable car I've ever bought. Wonderful car. I am a coach driver. I drive in England and abroad. And when I do get home, to get into my 75, is a sheer delight. Reliability on that car is superb. I've just had one little tiny problem with a door lock, which was rectified by the agents very, very quickly. That's a 1.8 club. That is very quick. I have proved it.
John Parkinson, you must be delighted. But before we dole out all the congratulations, the rest of the Rover range is still lagging behind a wee bit. You've got to improve that, haven't you?
Well, we are delighted to have our newest car to go straight in at the number five position in this important survey. Great news. We are learning a lot from the way that we manufacture the 75. We're putting a lot of attention into the rest of the range. We're now on one site at Longbridge. We're a new, young company, and we're putting a huge investment into quality, the benefit of the previous ownership, and that goes right the way across the range of Rover cars and with the MG cars.
With only the top four cars to go, we are well and truly ensconced in luxury land. And at number four, it's BM's biggest business barge, the 7 Series.
And at three, well, it's another Lexus, the GS300. And yet more proof that Toyota's luxury liner division can do this posh stuff better than almost anyone else.
Well, some manufacturers this year have proved they can provide a very high level of customer satisfaction for those on a budget. This car came second and it costs under £10,000. And it's no fluke. 5 out of our top 30 were from the budget end of the market.
These days, cheap doesn't necessarily mean nasty. Dave's cheeky Matthias checks in at 27th. Who'd have thought it would satisfy its owners more than a Porsche 911? 6 places higher and we have the Suzuki Wagon-R. Yes, it looks like a wardrobe, but its owners love its comfort and convenience. At 18, we have the Toyota Corolla, a virtually flawless performance from one of the best-selling cars in the world. Whilst its little brother, the Starlet, is just 3 places higher. So, what's at number 2?
Well, as if you needed any more proof, the car in second place is the Toyota Yaris. The fact that a small hatchback can provide as much satisfaction to its owners as, say, a Jaguar or Merc is absolutely fantastic.
And so, to the top car, the number one car out of all 182 surveyed, according to you.
The number one car in this year's Top Gear JD Power Customer Satisfaction Survey is the Lexus LS400. We've already heard owners love its seats and its stereo, but they also love the dealers and the way they look after you and the way it goes.
In fact, you loved everything about this car.
So there you have it. We've heard from Rover, Vauxhall and Mercedes, amongst others. They've all pledged to do better. In 12 months' time, you'll tell us whether they've delivered on their promises.
That's it from Top Gear for this week, but just in case you missed your car, came in late, or finally got as bored as we are of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, here's the whole list once again, from beginning to end. Good night.
Good night.
I think customer satisfaction is right at the core of the Lexus ethos, from the valeters at the local dealership, right the way through to the engineers that visit every market in the world to find out what customers want from a car before they start designing it. If we're famous for one thing, it's customer satisfaction.
And the results of the featured customer satisfaction survey are available in the May issue of BBC Top Gear magazine.